And today we're talking about the echoes of the grave. Remember the first time that you heard the echo? You were in a forest or maybe a canyon or a cave, and you yelled out, and what you said came back to you over and over again. The echo. And sometimes echoes follow us. Things that we say come back to us. Things that we have experienced come back to our mind. Echoes. I had one of those moments this week. You get the jury duty summons and you go to jury duty. It's really exciting. But for 2.5 days, I sat in this jury room with about 50 to maybe 60 people. And we all stood up and we were sworn in that everything that you say is going to be truthful. And after we got sworn in, the questions started becoming from the DA and from the prosecutor to the jurors. And this was a criminal case. Sexual misconduct, battery, violent. So they started asking questions. First question they asked was eye-opening. They said, I would like to ask you, any one of you, if you've ever been sexually abused, would you raise your hand? We're all under oath now. I knew not one person in that room. 50 people raised their hands. Here's the scary part. Then they asked, would you please explain the scenario? Under oath, these men and women had to communicate to the DA about their scenario, what took place. I tell you, I was sitting in the back, and I told you right now, I was in shock. Some of the things that they went through, whether they were looking like that they were worth $1 million, or they looked like they were homeless, everyone has stuff that they don't want to share, that they have in their life that have broken them and changed them, that has echoed out into their life, and it has hurt them to the core, and they don't know what to do. And I was sitting in the back as a preacher, and I hear this stuff all the time, and I was hurting. These ladies had to communicate. These men had to share. We're talking about abuse that caused suicide within their home. We're talking divorce left and right. We're talking violent beatings in front of a bunch of strangers. And I was just sitting there and I was listening to this stuff. And I started thinking about our church and started thinking about how much we may have that same vulnerability within the doors. And so many standing under oath, when they said, what would you say? What would we do? Would we judge or would we love? Would we wrap our arms around somebody that has major issues within their home and within their family or in their own personal life? Would we love them? Would we judge them? And as I was already preparing for Easter, I was thinking about the echoes from the grave, the lives that we live, the things that we do, the things that follow through. What would our echo be? What would our life echo be? When somebody would look at us, when somebody would hear us, when somebody would communicate to us, are we the type of people that under oath would share, but in most cases we hide, we put the blinds down? We don't want anybody to know our stuff, nor should we have to tell all of our stuff. But there's one person that does know our stuff. And when he went to the grave, his echo changed everything. And because of his echo, and because of what Jesus did for us, we can change the way that people perceive us and that we perceive ourselves. You know, these people in this courtroom, they didn't know anybody else in that room except for them. And in that courtroom, vulnerable, and honest. They shared some stuff that they probably haven't shared in front of a stranger their entire life. They opened up the curtain of their life and they shared. There were tears all over the place. The pain within their life. And at breaks, I got to do some things that a pastor gets to do. In those breaks, I got to talk to other individuals and I got to let people know that I'm a pastor. And during some of these issues, when these ladies or men would talk, I just found a way to go up and talk to them one-on-one. And I got to just share with them. Got to talk to them about their life and just minister to them, whether it's 30 seconds or a minute. Just let them know that I was moved with their story and I'm praying for them. I was moved. I was moved because of their life, their boldness, and the things that they went through. What do we do when our life is in chaos? And the echo that I want to talk to you about today is the echo from the grave. How Jesus can take our junk. How the world perceives sin, and the world treated him, and the world treats you. But because of what he did, he changes everything. Now, aren't you happy about that? Aren't you happy that Jesus, when we enter into a relationship with him, absolutely can change everything that we do? And I want to read John chapter 20, verses 1 through 8. And in this, it's this Easter story. We're going to be talking about this for 3 weeks, I think. It says, now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene, who went to the tomb early while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been moved away from the tomb. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to them, they have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have led him. Peter therefore went out and the other disciple, and when they were going to the tomb, they so ran together, and the other disciples outran Peter and came to the tomb first. And when he was stooping down and saw in, he saw the linen clothes lying there, yet he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb, and he saw that the linen clothes lying there and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who came in the tomb first went in also and saw, and he believed. An empty tomb. The echo of that empty tomb. Christmas and Easter are the Christian holidays that we get to share about Jesus openly and honestly. So let me tell you about the shouts, the echo out of this tomb. The first one is hate. The echo of hate. Some shout hate, but the tomb echoes love. The world hated Jesus. Let me set this picture up. As you very well know what took place, the world hated Jesus. And the day that he was crucified was a day of horror for him. A crown placed upon his head, beaten with sticks, with a cat of nine tails, his beard pulled from his face, spit upon and ridiculed, hung upon a tree naked. They hated him. They wanted to humiliate him. They hated everything that he stood for. But in the Beatitudes just a few months earlier, he says this in Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 and 44. You have heard that said, love your neighbors and hate your enemies. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. What he said, he had to do. Pray for those that hurt you. Love your enemies. Love those people that have harmed you. And Jesus now had to do what he taught. The world says hate, but I want to tell you, Jesus says love. And how, in the midst of hatred, can we love? The Bible says, greater love has no one than he lay down his life for his friends. Jesus taught us how to love. Loving. In the midst of a cruel world, in the midst of hatred, Jesus, Justin said this, 185,000 angels, 185,000 men were killed by one angel. God has power to do whatever he desires. These men, soldiers, crucifying, beating, spitting upon Jesus. Do you know what Jesus could have done? In a second, he could have commanded a legion of angels to come down and wipe out humanity. But Jesus' love for you and love for me kept him on that cross where he didn't have to go. He humbled himself to do what God asked him to do, to be the ransom for our sin. In the midst of hatred, he showed love. And the echo of that love is still going today. The echo of that love is for you and for me. The second echo is shouted as failure. But the echo is forgiveness. You know, you look at Jesus' life from the world standpoint, he is homeless. He was penniless. He didn't have anything. He healed people. He never went to the hospital. He taught as a rabbi, but he didn't have a school. He looked at the world as something that I can serve, and the world looked at him as, you're a failure. You don't have anything. They praised him one day and crucified him the next. The world would look at him as a complete failure. There's a phrase that he said on the cross. He says, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. And see, the Greek word there for Father, forgive them is an ongoing phrase, which means this. When Jesus was being crucified, when Jesus was being beaten, he would say, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. And then somebody else would beat them. His constant word was, Father, forgive them. Father, love them. Father, don't hold it against them. Every time somebody hated him, every time somebody hurt him, he would say, Father, forgive them. Father, they don't know what they're doing. They don't realize who I am. Forgive them. And even the night before he was crucified, his main man, Peter, he said, I will never denounce you. I will never deny you. And he followed him a ways off, and three times that night, he denied Jesus. He even cussed like a fisherman. Some of you guys, I've heard some of you talk before, and you understand that. He cussed. He didn't have any refrain. He was upset. He was scared. He reverted back to who he was. And he was afraid that after Jesus was resurrected, that Jesus would not forgive him. But Jesus called him by name and said, Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, I love you. Peter, do you love me? Yes, you know I do. Peter, do you love me? The three times that he denounced Jesus, Jesus said, I want to restore you. I want to restore you. I want to restore you. In your failures, Jesus gives you forgiveness. Now, forgiveness is a wonderful word. It's as if it never happened. Jesus looks at our sin. He looks at our problems. He looks at our issues. And he says, you are forgiven. There's nothing that I hold against you any longer. Even the woman caught in adultery, where are your accusers? I see none. Neither do I accuse you. Go, sin no more. Sometimes we feel like a failure. But in our failures, we can have forgiveness because of Jesus. I love that opportunity that we can have that forgiveness. Some shout, he's dead. But the tomb says, he's alive. They thought it was over. The religious leaders of the day said, he's finally done. We're taking him off the cross and we put him in the tomb before Passover and it's over with, it's done. We don't have to mess with this Jesus any longer. This guy was a blasphemer, he's a hypocrite. We don't have to mess with him. His followers will go away and his followers will never be heard of again. But when the world shouts he's dead, that's the start of a new life. And sometimes in our life, we have to be dead to ourselves so we can open up and have a new life. And sometimes when we die to ourselves, things change. Our life changes. Everything changes. So what happens to these men that follow Jesus? The world says he is dead, but Jesus is alive. We could go look at any tomb that we have, and we could see tombs, and tombs represent death. And in the last 25 years of me being in the pastorate, I have done many funerals. And it's very sad. On this Easter Sunday morning, it started off in a graveyard. It started off in a tomb, where it represents death. And you know, the older I get, the more reality this is, that there's a new statistic out that one out of every one person is going to die. That's sobering, isn't it? I'm 53 years old. I'm going to die. We don't like talking about death. Death is something that we get mad about God. And we say, why? But God says death is life for those that know Christ. We don't have to fear death because death is a stepping stone into Christ. But we go to a cemetery and we mourn because of the loss of our family. And I understand that. It's hard. I have buried my brother and I've buried my father. And when we look at death, it hurts. But death is life for those that know Christ. James was thrown off the corner of the temple and stoned. Bartholomew was skinned alive. Matthew was killed in Ethiopia. Mark was dragged through the streets until he was dead. James was beheaded. Jude was shot with arrows. Peter was crucified upside down. Paul was beheaded. These men that followed Christ, they all died. And none of them denounced their faith. They knew that to be alive in Christ, that they had to have faith in Christ. That gives them hope. That gives them security. We understand that death hurts, but we understand the closer that we get to death, the closer we get to Christ. It's not fun watching going through heartache in people's lives and when people get sick or during an accident. We've watched many people go through the mourning process and we've mourned with them, and it hurts. But for a believer, can I give you one verse that changes everything? For a believer, the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. We have to prepare for death. And we prepare for death in life. If we're afraid to communicate what takes place after death, we will never do what God wants us to do in life. It is very important that because of the cross, Jesus died and he arose again. Easter Sunday morning is a time that we get to proclaim the message that Jesus changed everything. He changed everything for me and he changed everything for you. When we were in India a few years ago, we had an extra day, so we went to the Hare Krishna temple. And at the Hare Krishna temple, it was packed full of individuals that wanted to worship Hare Krishna. And we just sat in the back and watched a bunch of preachers. Of the devotion, of the respect of that temple. And our guide was with us and we started asking him some questions about the temple. About what they can do and what they cannot do. And they go every day into this temple. And they bow before Hare Krishna. And they respect and honor and pray to a dead individual. And we have a live God that has proven that he has been alive from his death, rose again the third day, seen by many, and ascended into heaven. And sometimes we do not respect our God the way other religions respect their dead God. But because of his death, we have life. And I like this last one. Some shout hopeless, but the tomb shouts hope. We have hope. We have joy. We have peace. If Christ be not raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. If Jesus did not rise from the dead, if Jesus is still hopeless, if he lived 33 years and he died and that's all there is, why are we serving a dead God? But Jesus is alive. How do we know that? We never seen him with our eyes, but we hear him with our hearts. We watch what he does within our lives. You see families that were destitute, that are hurting, that are ready for divorce, and they give their life to Christ, and Christ heals their marriage and heals their life and changes everything about them. Our anchor, our hope is not in what we can do. Our hope is in what Christ can do through us. Sometimes we feel hopeless. Sometimes we feel hurt. And that's when God says, this is when I need you to bow on your knees and cry unto Christ. And in your hopeless state, let God give you hope. Hope. Positive. Desiring God to change your life. Desiring God to work within your life. When I was in the back of that courtroom this week, I couldn't tell you how my heart broke. These people had to share some things in front of strangers that I don't know I could share. They would call their name out. If you've been on jury duty in a criminal case, you know what they do. And they ask you a pointed question. A lady sitting right beside me. She lived in Oklahoma at the time. And her husband abused her physically, sexually, and abused their son physically and sexually. And she finally had enough courage, and she said, I was done. She filed for divorce. 2 weeks later, he shoots himself and kills him. She's sitting there, there are tears in her eyes, in front of a bunch of strangers, said, if I would have never filed for divorce, he'd still be alive. My heart is broken. The guy was beating the dog out of her. But yet she still blames herself for filing. And I just put my arm around her. Didn't know her from anybody in the world. I put my arm around her and I said, you deserve better. No woman should ever be abused. No woman should ever be assaulted. You did the right thing. He's the one that was wrong. And tears coming down her face. She goes, I cannot believe I just shared that story. I've never shared that story. She's sitting right beside me. I looked at her and I said, you're okay. And then I got to give her my card. I said, you need counseling, come on into the church, whatever the case is. But she was hopeless. And what does the church do? What's the church called to do? Is to give hope to the hopeless. To give peace to chaos. To allow people to see that Christ changes everything. And like we talked about last week, we are called to be Christ-like followers. What our job is, when people are hurting, when people are struggling, When the Holy Spirit of God breaks your heart and you are put in very awkward situations sometimes, love, don't judge. Help, don't hurt. And when we can do that, what we're trying to get into somebody's life is there's peace, there's hope, there's opportunity, because people are goofed up. You're goofed up. If you would have to stand under a plea and share your life, you'd be goofed up. You know, I had to write a survey, and I had to write my survey, and I've been a pastor here for 18 years, and a Baptist preacher at that, you know, so there's no way that anybody's going to ask me to be on a jury. So when you're sitting there and then they know who you are and what you do, and they know that you have the answer, and the answer that changes everything is Jesus. It's Jesus. It's simple, but it's something that we have to transfer from our heart, from our life, into somebody else's life. And you know what the greatest thing is? Just like when Peter denied Jesus, Jesus still used Peter. He used in a miraculous way. And sometimes we feel like that we have done too much, or we have failed so much, or God could never use us. Let me give you hope. God only uses people that are broken. God uses the weak things of this world to confound the wise. God uses the weak things to give strength to God. God wants to use us in our broken state to bring glory to Him. We don't have to be smarter than them. We don't have to be better than them. We don't have to have our life all together before we talk about Christ. When hurting people are hurting, Jesus uses Christ-like followers of Him to change people's lives and to give them hope. That's what Easter is all about. Easter is about sharing the good news of Jesus Christ into people that are struggling, even to people that think they have it all together. They don't. They have a facade on. They have the curtains drawn. But whenever you get into their life, whenever they allow you into their life, you will see that there's no difference between any other person and you. But God has called you. God has called me as Christians to help and to give hope to a dying, hurting, struggling world. What we have to do is we have to allow the echo of our life. Do you remember the first time you heard the echo? You're in amazement. How did that take place? And you yell out, hello, 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 hello. And it comes back. But in this echo, this is a supernatural echo. People do not understand. The world shouted hate. And the echo came back after it bounced off of Jesus and said, I love you. The world shouts failure, you're worthless. Once it goes through Jesus, it doesn't say failure. It says forgiven. We are forgiven. The blood that He shed cleanses us of all of our sin. You're forgiven. Greatest message ever is forgiven. And when we cry out hope, the world cries hopeless, yells, and says there is no hope. Jesus gives to us the greatest gift of I can look forward to tomorrow. I can get up in the morning. Maybe a long night. We may have to go through a lot of struggles personally. But Jesus gives us hope at the end of the day. And He gives us a purpose to get up tomorrow morning to honor Him and to know that He loves me unconditionally. The echo of our life is what we say follows through. And what we have to do is we have to be transparent. We will be vulnerable. But what we must do is be the giver of the greatest message of Jesus into people that are struggling. This week was eye-opening for me. I have done this line of work since I've been 21 years old. But I have never felt the way I felt this week. I didn't like it, but it was good for me. It was good for me to see people in a vulnerable state. But here's what I had to do. I couldn't just see them in that state. I was moved with compassion for them. I was moved to tears for some of them. And I was motivated to love. I would have never seen them. They walked in. They had everything together. But in a moment, in a second, when the question was given, the countenance fell. Because honesty had to be given. George Tiller's security guard was on there. You look at that, you little scoundrel. But he told his story. I was moved with love. Abuse cases. I was moved with love. There was something about hearing somebody in their vulnerable state that should change the way that you perceive them. And when you are moved with compassion, give them hope. Give them Jesus. Because he is the only one that can forgive. And he's the only one that can take us to heaven.